Well, Dr. Raj Kalsi is a board-certified emergency medicine physician, and he's joining me now from Naperville in Illinois. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you, Rosemary.
So we are witnessing a global spike in COVID-19 infections, and in the US, an increase in cases in about 23 states and record high hospitalizations in some states. All this as the US death toll surpasses 120,000. How concerned are you about this? And of course, how ready is this country for another surge in hospitalizations?
That's an excellent question. And I'm concerned. I'm mostly concerned about the upcoming flu virus that's annual and the other seasonal viruses in the late fall and early winter. And I juxtapose those concerns against the fact that healthcare is hemorrhaging money right now because of COVID. Much like so many industries have lost money, Rosemary, I'm worried about the healthcare industry not having enough dollars to go back on another lockdown. Stopping surgeries, stopping things that generate cash for the industry to pay everybody that works in the industry, therefore to take care of patients. And this spike in surge is certainly concerning. In my area, fortunately, we're seeing less and less COVID, but we're awfully concerned about the next fever and flu-like illness coming up pretty soon.
Yeah, understandable. And of course, the hope that there'll be enough personal protective equipment, that was the big problem last time, wasn't it? And President Trump now says he never ordered a slowdown in coronavirus testing, despite saying he would do exactly that when he spoke at his Tulsa rally on Saturday. What would be the consequences of him slowing down testing at a time when cases are surging? And is there sufficient testing in this country right now?
It would be catastrophic. I'm not sure where he generates his commentary. That's not my position here. But I can tell you scientifically, and it's common sense tells you that more testing is fundamentally the most important thing. And that is because we need to know exactly how many people have it, this coronavirus, and therefore we need to know the numbers and base that against the people that are hospitalized and the people that unfortunately die from this, so we can generate a true tally on how infectious and how deadly this disease is. If we slow down testing, unfortunately, I think we'd be in a much worse spot than we were when we began this.
And doctor, also at his Tulsa rally, President Trump mocked the wearing of masks, and now we learn eight of his campaign staffers and two Secret Service agents have tested positive for COVID-19. What decision needs to be made about masks as we await the CDC's imminent update on its recommendation on the wearing of masks?
It comes down to what America's tolerance is of restricting what they think are their rights. A certain percentage of this country, I'd say a big percentage of this country, overtly cares about how they affect their neighbor and their families. And they're willing to do, it seems like, what scientists think is the appropriate thing to do, which is wearing masks as the most minimum thing that you can do when you go out in public. If we don't do that, and the other half of the country that does not feel like that's necessary, we then need to consider, and again, I'm not a government spokesman, but I guess the government would consider, do we mandate it? And then if we mandate it, will there be social discord and chaos because certain people are gonna fight it and resist that scientific evidence? And then the downfall of social chaos in the streets, which we're unfortunately all too familiar with lately.
Yeah, indeed. And of course, we are seeing it mandated in California, in Miami, in Phoenix. The science behind it, as you say, is that it clearly does protect people. Is it really the only weapon we have right now as we wait for a vaccine or some sort of antiviral treatment? Is the mask the only way we can live as normal a life as possible?
It is one component. The other component is paying special attention to our just personal hygiene. Part of how we have advised families that are insistent that they want to relax social distancing amongst their own families is we simply recommend you need to shower vigorously and clean yourselves vigorously before you expose yourself to more vulnerable family members. And subsequently, if you're around family members and have to leave the home, you make a decision that you don't go back to that household for a couple of days to control the spread and contamination of that household. We need to be very cautious about our own hygiene. And this will only help, Rosemary, the spread of flu and other viruses. We have to remember there are hundreds of viruses that we're not talking about. And these simple measures will actually help mitigate the infectious component of those viruses and how many people those unfortunately kill every year, like influenza.
Yeah, it's a very important point. Dr. Raj Kalsi, thank you so much for joining us. We do appreciate it.
Thanks for having me, Rosemary.